Hello everybody, welcome back to my studio. In today's workshop, you'll be watching me complete another painting using acrylic paints, and I'm going to be talking about some very essential tips and techniques that you can use to make your paintings better and bolder. So let's get to it. So to start things off, I'm just going to spray a lot of water on my entire canvas to make it easy to work on. And then I'm going to give it a nice bright orange colored ground before I start making my drawing. Now, I've already spoken about the importance of a colored ground in my last workshop, but I want to add something new here. Another one of the reasons why I like going for colored grounds because that it gives you a very strong sense of energy. Now, if you're using a photograph as a reference and you're just copying a figure on your painting, then you don't really get that sense of action. So you really need some color dynamic working for you to make that happen. Now, different colors can help you create different kinds of moods as well. For me, I feel like using opposite colors really creates a visual bounce. So I've already chosen a picture that I will be painting today.
It's a beautiful picture of a ballerina midway through her dance routine by the NYC Dance Project. And it has a really nice range of tonal variation happening in the photograph, and I would really like to translate that picture using complementary colors today and show you how to paint skin tones without using very realistic colors.
Now, while you watch me sketch this drawing out, I also want to talk about something really important, which is called a value sketch. I think for aspiring artists and painters, it's very, very essential that you learn how to translate the forms and volumes of the visual world into flat pieces of value, and to arrange those pieces into effective patterns. Now, this is what people call the artist's eye, or you might have heard design sense. So this is actually just a special way of seeing and thinking, and it's different for each person. And it is acquired gradually through repetition, through a lot of practice, like any other complex skill. Creating a preliminary three-value sketch will really help you to see the dark, light, and middles a lot better when you start painting. So you'll see that I will be spending a lot more time on developing my initial sketch, and I'm actually going to fill in and shade out the few darker areas here so that it helps me plan out my painting a little better beforehand and before I actually start applying paint.
In my drawing, you'll notice that I am going to just leave out the really light areas as the bright orange of the background, and I'm going to shade out the darker values here. I also strongly believe that when you're working within self-imposed limitations, for example here when I'm working with just three values, the lights, midtones, and the darks, it often results in very surprising discoveries. And later on, when you actually go on to use a fuller range of values and you're using other colors and paints, you'll have a much deeper understanding of the possibilities of that range and a much greater fluency in using it as well. Now we're going to talk about something very important in the painting process, which is the color selection. Now you want the colors that you've chosen to really work well together, and it can get a little confusing at first to know how many colors to use and which ones work together better.
So the color wheel that we artists use is the RYB color palette, which is the red, yellow, and blue color palette, which is a subtractive color palette. Now, when I say subtractive, I mean that when you mix colors, they become darker. Now there's a number of ways that you can use this color wheel to choose a color palette for your paintings. But there are three main ones that I'm going to talk about in today's video. You can either go for an analogous color scheme, a triadic color scheme, or the one that I chose to go with, a complementary color scheme.
So a quick introduction about the three color schemes that I just mentioned. So analogous colors are three or more colors that are next to each other on the color wheel. Analogous color schemes are usually used in paintings to make them look more harmonious. But the actual feeling conveyed will really depend on the colors that you choose, based mostly on the temperatures, warm colors versus cold colors. I've already spoken a little about the mood of the paintings that you can set by choosing the temperature of the colors in my last video as well. Now, just a quick word about the triadic color scheme. It's basically taking three colors that are equally spaced on the color wheel. To use a triadic harmony successfully, and this goes the same for actually all three of the color palettes, the colors should be carefully balanced. So you can let one color be more dominating and use the other two colors for an accent. And now finally about the last color scheme, which is the complementary color scheme, and also one of my favorites to use. In color theory, complementary colors are the ones that are opposite to each other on the color wheel. So for instance, the complementary color of red would be green, the complementary color of blue would be orange, and these are the ones that I'm using in my painting. The color complement of each primary color, which is red, yellow, and blue, can be obtained by mixing the other two primary colors together. So for example, with red, you're going to mix yellow and blue and you'll get the complementary color, which is green. The complementary of blue is orange, which will be a mixture of red and yellow, and the complementary of yellow is violet, which is a mixture of red and blue. When you're using complementary colors in your painting, the end result will always be very high contrast and it will be very vibrant. So it really brings out the pop in colors here. Okay, so next I really want to talk about a few tips on composing your composition. So I'm just going to give you a few basic guidelines that will really help you strengthen your design and overall compositions. We've already spoken about the importance of a value sketch earlier on in this video. Now, when you're making a value sketch, be a little careful to have a dominant value in your sketch. Now, the boldest compositions have a dominant value. So just try to avoid having equal amounts of each value in your composition. For example, in my painting over here, you'll notice that the majority of my painting is going to be blue. So the orange in its limitations really stand out, and it's the color that I'm using as the highlight anyway. Which means that my dominant value in this painting is going to be the darker values, in which case I'm using this bright cerulean blue. Now, the second very important point that you need to focus on when composing your composition is called the focal point.
Now, when I say focal point, I mean deciding where you want your viewer's eye to land when they look at your painting.
And a properly designed composition will lead the viewer's eye right to it.
So another interesting element that you can bring to your paintings is by cropping the subject. Now, a lot of beginner artists tend to make this mistake that they try to put their focal subject right smack in the middle of the canvas.
Cropping some elements slightly off the picture area, I think, is a much more interesting way that creates more variety in the negative space. A simple technique to avoid placing your subjects in the middle of the canvas is just simply following the rule of thirds.
So the rule of thirds is a very interesting composition technique that you can use in your paintings and your drawings, and you'll notice that a lot of artists and photographers are already using this because it almost never fails. So the rule of thirds states that you're going to place your focal point along an imaginary intersection of lines vertically and horizontally that divide your canvas into thirds.
Now, while we talk about the rule of thirds, I just want to give a quick history lesson over here, which is a really interesting fact that I find. Is that the rule of thirds was actually the creation of painters in the Renaissance period. Their aim of this style of composition was basically to provide a little bit of background in their paintings so that it allows it to tell a story. The Renaissance painters believe that the eye doesn't really rest in the center of a painting, but instead the eye wants to roam with the subject. So on why the rule of thirds always works, there's a timeless theory that's been proven that way. I guess one way to explain how it works is to think of it like this. Now, if your subject is in the middle of the image, it is automatically very static. Your eye is just drawn to it and has nowhere really else to go because the object is in equal distances from all sides. But if you had positioned your subject a little closer to maybe one of the edges, it forces your eye to sort of follow it and to find it. So it allows the viewer to just linger on your image a little longer. It makes for a more captivating photo because it's almost very interactive. It would almost seem like it's a conversation that's going on between the painting and you. Okay, lastly, the tip that I would like to give you on composition is variety. The eye loves variety. It's intrigued by unequal divisions of space and alignment and differences in shapes, edges, textures, etc. So just try to create compositions that are more dynamic,
A few suggestions would be, try to make the divisions of space around and between objects unequal and uneven, so the negative spaces are more exciting to look at. Avoid trying to align objects on a very horizontal or a vertical axis. If your composition is starting to feel too geometric, then you know you can consider adding or emphasizing an organic shape for more visual contrast. Just alternate your brushwork edges, contrast hard, sharp edges near the focal point with soft feathery edges in the subordinate areas, just to give more variety for the eye to just kind of move on.
Now, if you go back to the work of the Impressionists, you'll notice that they were the first ones to use the complementary colors and to actually observe that shadows are made by complementary tones and not by using blacks.
Shadows of objects will always contain its complementary color. So, for example, the shadow of a green apple will contain some red.
So this is a tip that I spoke about even in my previous video, and I want to stress about it again in this video, is to choosing larger brush sizes.
Upsizing your brush does a few things, which is increasing your brushwork economy, which means that you're going to really think about the strokes that you're putting on your canvas, and also it's going to make covering up your canvas with paint a lot quicker.
Now the key here is to make all of your brush strokes really count. They have to be made with a lot of decision and precision.
So another thing that I would really like for you to focus on my painting today is how to make expressive brush marks for a very bold painting. And quite simply, it's just don't blend and don't tidy up. Just allow the marks that are left by the shape of the brush and its hairs to really show. Don't just brush back and forth to eliminate lines and blend in that are left by the individual hairs from the brush. Be very decisive and be very bold in moving the brush across the canvas. And especially don't neglect the background. Over here, I'm using two different tones to just create some visual interesting pattern or shifts in color. You know, two bright shades of blue across a really intense shade of orange. And another thing that I really like doing a lot in my paintings is, since I paint a lot of dancers and ballet dancers and I want to show more movement, I really like to just paint the air that they've disturbed. So it sounds very simple, but it's also very easy to just do badly, so it's a wild mess of brush marks that a viewer won't be able to interpret. It can be a little hard sometimes to resist the temptation of just quickly let me touch up this bit and, you know, end up overworking an area. So there's another tip that I would like to give you, that as soon as you find yourself fiddling or hesitating, just stop. Just stop and leave the painting overnight for a fresh consideration in the morning. Now, an interesting way to really highlight your focal point is to place your lightest and darkest values in the closest proximity to each other at a certain point. If the values are going to be scattered, then they won't really offer any type of path toward the focal point, and the viewer won't know where to engage with the painting. So for example, in my painting over here, you'll notice that I want the focal point to be the woman's face here. And so I've applied the darkest blue right next to my really bright orange. And since the colors are also complementary, they're really supporting each other's in their vibrancies. And there's really no confusion where the viewer's eye is going to land as soon as they look at my painting here. We'll be right back.
lastly, all I want to say is that I really want to stress on the fact how important it is to keep practicing. I've given you these basic and essential tips and techniques, and they're only going to get better if you keep practicing at them, and they will help you to make better and bolder paintings. So this was my entire painting process, and I hope you guys enjoyed it and learned something new from it. If you have any comments and suggestions, do leave them down in the comments below and I'll be sure to get to them. Don't forget to subscribe and like my page, and I'll be sharing some more video workshops with you very soon. Thank you so much for watching again.